I'm wondering if there are uses of CRISPR that, I mean, we actually could get true international cooperation. There are so few areas that we see governments working together to collaborate and cooperate. Is this one that you think that we should be optimistic about?
I don't know if I'm optimistic. I'm actually on a committee right now that's organizing a meeting on genome editing, and we're going to have a specific focus on human genome editing. And I think what's been very interesting with this, and as the topic has kind of continued to be discussed and presented in these international meetings, and reports have been written that have, you know, kind of come out with various kinds of guidelines and criteria around that type of science, it's been very interesting to see how the international community actually has largely coalesced around a set of standards that we all agree are appropriate. Now, does that mean that governments would honor that in the legal system? It's hard to say, but I certainly think that from the perspective of, you know, using the scientific community to regulate, if you will, the kind of science that happens, it's been actually very effective, I would say.
So, I mean, this is, I assume, a group of the leading scientists from all over the world that are working on this issue. And what you're telling me is there's actually been a lot more willingness to agree on topics that would be pretty controversial than you would have expected going into these three meetings so far.
Absolutely. Yeah. I'm just guessing here, but I think part of it is that for biological systems, and especially if we're talking about the human body, each of us feels very personally invested in that, right? We've each got a body, and we've got, you know, if we have families, we have loved ones that, you know, might be affected by things that affect our bodies. I think there's just a very visceral kind of interaction, a feeling that, you know, we're kind of all in this together, and it's very much a real-time effort. You know, these things are going to affect us, and so we need to pay attention to them, versus, at least for some people, can feel a bit more removed. They're not quite sure how that impacts them personally, and there's lots of other things to worry about, so maybe it isn't something they need to engage with.
Is there that sense of inevitability that, I mean, we're just going to be, you know, quote unquote, playing God? We're going to be creating, adapting life as humanity, and the only question is how long it takes us to get there.
Yes, I would say absolutely. I think that all of us that have been actively, you know, working on these, whether it's these international summits or the World Health Organization report, or, you know, there's lots of venues where people have been involved in crafting the, you know, the language around how genome editing will be deployed in the future. And I think across the board, at least in those scientific circles, there's the sense that you just said, basically, that this will happen. It's a matter of time. And so the important thing to do now is to try to make sure that it happens in the most ethical and responsible fashion.
We know that inequality in the world is growing for lots of reasons, economic reasons, climate-related reasons. What do we need to watch out for? What do we need to do to minimize or at least reduce the level of disenfranchisement that come from some people having access or earlier access to this kind of life-changing technology?
Well, certainly the first step is just acknowledging what you just said. And I think that's, you know, we have to acknowledge that that is one of the really big challenges with, frankly, with any new technology, but certainly with what we're talking about here with CRISPR, because it is a technology that, at least in the early stages, is going to be very expensive. So, for example, the therapy that's being based on CRISPR that's being used right now to treat sickle cell patients is costing between $1 and $2 million a patient. And, you know, that's clearly just not a price point that will make it affordable and available to everyone globally who can benefit from it. What do we do about that? That's the question I ask myself the most, I would say. I really think about this a lot. we have a unique opportunity to focus our work around that question, in the sense that when we do the science that we're doing it from the standpoint of, how do I think about making this technology affordable and available to people in the future? And one of the big ones is, you know, we're working on ways that we can deliver the CRISPR molecules much less expensively into patients in the future. And I think that will be one of the ways that we can, you know, help mitigate costs. And then, of course, there's also going to be the scale of this. Right now, you know, this is being used in just a handful of patients for good reasons. It's being still in a testing phase. But eventually we're going to, you know, if it is proven to be safe and effective for people, then I think we're going to want to work as quickly as possible to scale it to a point where that also helps bring down the cost.